on, man? How you doing?
I dude sitting on the porch waiting on the school bus.
Yeah, waiting for the kids to come back, doing some in school finally, huh?
Yeah, man. He got to go back to school. They went back a while ago, but we went on like a mini vacation to the Smokies and just kind of went and stayed in the cabin for a few days. So he got to miss a week of school. So getting him to go back this week was a pain in the ass. Oh my God.
Yeah, once those kids get in vacation mode, man, forget. I mean, I'm the same way. Once I get on vacation mode, forget it. I won't go back to work or do anything.
Same.
So I was literally just jamming out to the new album as I was waiting for this to get going. And I just popped up your cover of ELO's Don't Bring Me Down, and I was rocking to it, man. Great job, dude, on that.
Thanks, man. That was a fun one. We literally just took it from being more of a keyboard-driven song to a guitar-driven song, you know, and kind of fuzzed the guitars up a little bit and went with it.
Yeah, we're talking to Chris from Blackstone Cherry, and the new album is out now. It came out in October of 2020. So a lot of bands have been putting music out in 2020, which was obviously the most difficult year to try to do something like that. And first of all, I'll just throw it out there right now. It's like, you know, it was cool that bands did put out new music, so we had something to enjoy and consume. Did you guys have to wrestle with when to put this album out due to everything that was going on?
A little bit. There was a small degree of back and forth, but really the only, you know, thing we had that was solid and wasn't, you know, potentially going away was the fact that we could put our album out. So we were like, mm-hmm. You know what? This is the only one shining light of this year for us as a band. Let's leave it what it is. Let's go ahead and put the record out, even though we can't tour. Let's do something to stay active.
Was October kind of like the normal date for it to come out anyway? Or did it get moved around? Yeah.
I think we ended up pushing back like 2 weeks or something from the original date, just to coincide with some other things we wanted to do, the live stream and all that stuff. But, you know, we stuck, you know, we kept it in the same month. So that was good.
Now, talk about from, you know, some of our fans that might not know, you know, got on the, you know, the lonely train a little late, shall we say.
Yeah.
You guys started in the early 2000s when you first really got together. And it's been kind of a long road for you guys. You guys have been a long, like, hardworking band for a long time. It's been a slow build.
Yeah, dude, it's been, this year is 20 years of Blackstone Cherry. And we put our first record out in 2006. And, you know, we've, like you said, it's just been slow in the States, especially. You know, we do really well in Europe and really well in the UK. But it, man, we're just thankful that in this business, after all these years, we can still be here doing it.
Yeah, it's crazy. I was seeing some of like, I guess you had some EPs or something that you released in Europe that were going for like 200 euros. You know, on the secondary market, it's like, it's crazy.
It's crazy, man. You know, we can go over there and play Wembley Arena in London for 10,000 people. And then we come back home and, you know, we may have 200 people. It's crazy, but, you know, it's still rock and roll regardless. It beats a 9-to-5.
What do you think? I mean, because obviously you guys are just a hardcore Southern rock band. I mean, there's like people throw other descriptions. I mean, it's Southern rock. It's as Southern rock as you can get. Why do you think that? Is it just because maybe it's different in Europe and they just don't get a lot of it there? Or
I don't know, man. I mean, that's kind of the legit $1 million question. You know, if we could figure that out, then we'd be, trust me, we'd be doing the same thing in the States that we're doing over there. But, you know, like I said, we're just thankful that we can do it somewhere.
Now, being from like, you know, Kentucky, was it hard to, when you start first traveling around the country and like, here you are doing like your brand of Southern rock, did you get a lot of like, oh, it's just like a Skinner type band? And did you have to like kind of fight that stereotype a bit?
Not really. I mean, because we've always been, you know, we've always just considered ourselves a rock and roll band. I mean, obviously we're Southern. You can tell that in our accents, but, and obviously, you know, there's a huge influence of Southern music, but I think for us, man, that, you know, we've never been, I mean, yeah, we go play shows with Skinner, but it's never been something that we're not afraid of being called a Southern rock band because, I mean, it is definitely part of who we are, you know?
Now, when the and everything kind of gets going again, how are you guys going to go about? Like, because I was talking to some other bands and they're like kind of just scared that everybody wants to tour at the same time. You're going to have such a backlog of touring. Have you guys tried to, have you even like dipped your toe into trying to navigate the unveiling of America once again when we can open back up?
Man, we've got a lot of stuff on the books. We'll just have to see if it happens. You know, I mean, unfortunately, that's the name of the game, is just making sure your booking agent is proactive and getting these holds for these places, you know, in the event that we do get to open back up.
Now, when it came to playing music, were you self-taught? Did you take lessons?
Man, I'm pretty much self-taught. My dad showed me how to make chords, and then everything else, it was, you know, if you want to be good, you'll learn this on your own, and handed me a stack of vinyl.
Did you say you just listen to it and try to copy everything you heard? What were some of the albums he gave you?
Man, there was a Mountain Twin Peaks live record in there, some Sabbath, Skinner, the Back in Black record was a big one for me. And then there was a lot of country records too, man. I mean, it was like an incredible collection of music from like the late 60s through the 70s that, you know, even up through the 80s with Back in Black, you know, Ted Nugent records and just a lot of the right guitar stuff. So luckily, you know, my dad was a guitar player too, and he had listened to a lot of the stuff that, you know, in turn that I ended up liking because I'd heard it so much.
Did it come pretty easy to you? Did you have to, was it like just, you know, 10 hours a day sitting in your bedroom listening and playing?
Man, I gave up two or three times. And then I finally decided just to stick with it. And once I got past that initial, you know, just learning curve of doing something new, it all came fairly quick. You know, and dude, I still learn every day. You know, I'm on YouTube watching dudes like Chris Buck and all these other guys, you know, play guitar. And I'm like, how do they do that? You know, but that's the beauty of it, is it's something that, you know, no matter how quick you do learn, you can always learn something else.
Now, when it came to singing, how was, did that just kind of come naturally, or did you have to work on that?
Hell no, that was a nightmare. I never wanted to be the singer, man. I just wanted to play guitar, and we couldn't find anybody to sing. And I was the only guy that didn't sound like somebody else, you know, so I kind of got stuck with the gig, and I had to learn how to sing from there. But, you know, man, my family's always been real musical, and my dad sang, my grandpa sang. I mean, so I do have the musical thing in my family. So I guess it was just more or less pulling out, you know, a voice out of me and learning how to use that voice.
What kind of, like, did you have, like, any struggles early with, like, losing your voice during shows? Did you have any of those kind of nightmares going on?
I have lost my voice a couple times over the years. I actually had to have a nodule removed back before we did the new record. I had surgery 3 days before we went in the studio, and then 2 weeks after surgery, I was singing the new record. But, you know, man, it's just wear and tear. 20 years of singing the way I do, you know, I sing hard, and, you know, we don't use any kind of tracks or any kind of backing tracks or anything live. It's all 100% what you hear is coming out of us on stage. So, you know, some nights it's there, and some nights you're trying everything you can and you just can't get there. And that's the worst feeling in the world as a singer, when your instrument goes out and you can't do anything to help get it back.
It is amazing too, because I've seen you guys on some support before. I guess I saw you on that Shinedown package that they do, Carnival Madness.
Yeah, yeah.
Caught you guys on that, and I caught you guys actually up in the Boston area. One of the radio stations up there did a big festival, like right around when you first came out, like 2006.
Okay.
So, and I remember, like, every time I saw you guys, it's like everyone around me who watches, like, who are these guys? Like, why do I know about them? And then, so you guys really have to, like, keep, yeah, the live show really does bring in a lot of people. And I know you guys have been, like, hard working trying to get these live shows. What are some of the challenges you get into markets, maybe, that you're not getting as much radio play? I mean, is it just like trying to support another band that does and hope you can get people out there early and win them over when they see you?
Man, you know, for us, radio's always been hit or miss. Like, you know, we've had songs on really like the first three records we had songs where they did pretty well at radio, you know, and then after that, we just kind of went a different direction with our music and didn't really push as hard for being played on radio anymore. We just went out and did it, you know, touring with bands that were more lifestyle bands and things like that. And then now, you know, with the new record, we're getting more radio love than I think we ever have. And it's amazing. So it'll be exciting to see how the show's different now, you know. But in the past, man, you know, we would still go play those markets. Even though the radio station wasn't playing us, we'd still go there and play those markets. And, you know, each time, you know, maybe the first time we played, we had 130 people as a band that's been out for over a decade. And we look at that as going, we got no support in this town. So the fact that we brought in, you know, this many people, if the promoter will have us back, we'll definitely go back and bring in hopefully more people next time. And that's the way it's gone. You know, you just we've been fortunate enough to find some promoters in certain areas that believe in the band and have seen the growth over the years and you know it's a long haul process. But I think the thing about that is when it is a long haul process and you develop those fans over time, they tend to stick with you, you know, instead of like, oh, you come out and you have like a couple of huge radio songs and then you don't do anything for a long time. Those people are like, what was that band again? You know, and you see that happen, you know, where bands come and go. And, you know, we haven't been as successful, not nearly as successful as a lot of our colleagues on the radio, but we're still here touring, man. And I think there's something to be said for that.
Yeah, I mean, I guess, you know, the end of the day, as long as you can, you know, make a living doing music, a comfortable living, you don't, it might not be Motley Crue and Tommy Lee with the Ferraris and racing the Batmobile or something like that, but still, you carved out a niche and you get to wake up in the day and, write music and play music. And then when things get going again, tour music and, hang out and promote an album while you're waiting for your kid to get off the school bus.
Right. I mean, dude, here's the thing. And at the end of the day, if one of these days one of our songs finally connects with American radio, then you know what, dude, that would be absolutely amazing. But if it doesn't, you know, we're continually thankful for the stations that do play us and, you know, are more than happy to spend time talking with them. You know what I mean? It's for us, we just want to continue to see our band grow because we want to be able to do this until we can anymore, you know, and the only way to do that is if we're continually growing. So
Well,
thank you for taking the time to talk to a guy like me, you know,
hey,
that's in a band that hasn't always been on the radio, you know.
yeah, been like on and off the radar a lot in a lot of spots, especially New Jersey. New Jersey's it's a tough
Yeah,
one.
man.
Oh yeah, I'll be the first to admit, New Jersey is a weird place. You know, we're a weird
Yeah, dude.
area, a weird place. Well,
Hey,
the
man.
human. Oh, go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
I was gonna say, well, the human condition is out now. I suggest to everybody watching this interview, go to the back catalog of Blackstone Cherry and get yourself caught up, because there's some bangers in that back
Thank
catalog
you.
from
Thanks,
you
man.
guys. I mean, it's just good. Grab a cheap beer and a bottle of whiskey and put it on your bar, crank it up, and maybe work on your muscle car or something. Well, I mean,
Right.
that's like when I hear Blackstone Cherry, like that's like, well, that's the soundtrack to drinking a Coors Banquet beer with some Jameson whiskey and, and trying to get a few more, horsepower out of the old Challenger,
I do that. I mean, that sounds like a hell of a Friday night to me. You know what I mean?
Well,
You just
again,
all you're missing is the grill with the burgers and hot dogs going, man.
I gotta get that going. No, I can't do everything. I can only, one hand's on a wrench, the other's on the beer,
Well, let's be honest. You being from Jersey, you can only get so redneck with it. You know what I mean?
Oh, you'd be surprised. You come next time you come to Atlantic City, we'll take you on the outskirts a little bit.
Oh God, I don't know, man. I don't know if I can handle it.
We got this little area called the Pine Barrens, and it gets I lived in Georgia for a while. I went
Yeah.
to school at University of Georgia, and the Pine Barrens, it gets kind of comparable to the redneck, with mudding in the Pine Barrens and a lot of
Oh, dude,
fishing
look
going
here.
on and a lot of
Man,
hunting.
what so 3 or 4 summers ago, we went and got a couple four-wheelers. And for several summers, all we would do, if I was home on a weekend, we were at a local place where they just have like trails. A guy, you go pay this guy $5 a person, and he's got like hundreds of acres of trails, and it's in a river bottom, to go mudding, and that's what we would do, man. And it was so much fun.
Yep. And then I'll see, like, I'll come home some nights, I'll see all the pickup trucks lined up the Wawa, just all mudded out, and because they're out in the pines all night. I'm telling you, we got some redneck games going on out here. You'd be surprised.
Hell yeah, dude. I'm all about it.
Next time you're in town, you know, I'll give you I'll see if I can rent some four wheelers and we'll get the tour.
Oh, dude, it'd be awesome. I think last time we were in Atlantic City, man, was it?
I think it was the Carnival of Madness. Wasn't it?
About to say, dude, Carnival Madness, yeah. That, and then the one before that probably would have been, what, with Chickenfoot at the House of Blues?
That's right, yeah, right before, not too long after the House of Blues closed, that shut down, not too long after that. Yeah, Sammy.
That was a cool venue, yeah. The House of Stairs.
That was a cool, that was a great venue. We missed that one, dear. The hotel sold and, I don't know, turned into a water park or something. But we got other venues now. We got a Hard Rock now.
Nice.
Yeah, Ocean Casino Resort has a pretty good stage set up, and they've been doing shows, you know, once things get going back up. So we got some spots for you when the time's right.
That'll be awesome, man.
All right, Chris. Well, thanks for your time this afternoon, and we'll talk to you soon.
Yeah, have a good one, man.
All right, take care.